Technology. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk threatens to stop funding an internet service that the Ukrainian military has been using in its fight against Russia. Then consolidating power. Chinese President Xi Jinping prepares to tighten his grip on authority at an upcoming Communist Party gathering, emulating his political hero, Chairman Mao.
It follows Mao in the way he governs the party. The cult of personality, it's very Mao style.
And it's Friday. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh in on the January 6th committee's decision to subpoena former President Trump and what's at stake in the upcoming midterm election. All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Pediatric Surgeon, Volunteer, Topiary Artist, a Raymond James Financial Advisor, tailors advice to help you live your life. Life well planned.
And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Jim and Nancy Bilton, and Kathy and Paul Anderson.
Actually, you don't need vision to do most things in life. But it's exciting to be part of a team driving the technology forward. I think that's the most rewarding thing. People who know BDO.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
Russia's President Vladimir Putin is insisting he has no regrets over the war in Ukraine in the face of international pressure and internal dissent. Putin spoke today as Russian missiles again blasted the Ukrainian city of Zaporizhia, but he said he never intended to destroy Ukraine.
What is happening today is unpleasant, to put it mildly. But we would have to face the same situation later, in worse conditions for us. That's it. So we are acting correctly and on time.
Putin also said that his unpopular mobilization of Russian reservists should be finished in 2 weeks. Separately, Moscow promised free accommodations today for pro-Russian civilians fleeing Ukraine's military advances. In this country, police in Raleigh, North Carolina, say a 15-year-old boy is in critical condition after killing 5 people last night. He allegedly shot the victims on neighborhood streets and a nearby walking trail. Hours later, he was cornered and arrested, but it's unclear how he was wounded. Nicole Ellis has our report.
A slaughter in North Carolina, the latest chapter in an all-too-familiar American story. In an East Raleigh neighborhood, residents were forced to take shelter for hours as police hunted a suspect in a shooting rampage. By 10 p.m., they had captured a white 15-year-old boy accused of killing at least 5 people and wounding 2 more. His motive is still unclear. Today, the city's mayor called the violence tragic and needless.
There are several families in our community waking up this morning without their loved ones. We grieve for them today.
The Associated Press reports Thursday's shooting was the 25th U.S. mass killing this year, with 4 or more killed, not counting the gunman. And among last night's dead, an off-duty Raleigh police officer heading to work as the shooting began. It added to an already bloody week for police, with officers shot in at least 7 states. In Connecticut on Wednesday, 2 officers were killed and another injured after apparently being drawn into an ambush while investigating a possible domestic dispute. In all, FBI data shows 49 law enforcement officers have been killed in the first 9 months of this year, compared with 54 at the same point last year. But ambushes of police are on the rise. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Nicole Ellis.
In a statement today, President Biden said too many families have lost loved ones to mass shootings. He called again for a ban on assault weapons. The U.S. Justice Department asked a federal appeals court today to end an outside review of documents taken from former President Trump. A federal judge in Florida authorized a special master to examine the White House records found at the Trump estate in Florida. Today's filing argues that the judge overstepped her authority. In Australia, flooding from heavy rainfall has inundated parts of the country's second most populous city. Officials say that some 500 homes have flooded in Melbourne and other cities across Victoria State in the southeast. Crews have rescued more than 100 people in the past 48 hours. The swollen rivers there are expected to remain dangerously high for days. Climate change protesters in London threw tomato soup today on a Van Gogh painting at the National Gallery of Art. The activists attacked the iconic work, Sunflowers, and then glued their hands to the wall to protest against fossil fuels. They were later arrested. Gallery officials said that the artwork was protected by glass. Britain's Prime Minister Liz Truss fired her Treasury chief today and abandoned plans to drop a corporation tax hike. The value of the pound had plummeted to record lows after she announced tax cuts financed with borrowed money. Today, Truss said that she wanted to reassure markets, but she dismissed calls that she resign.
I'm absolutely determined to see through what I've promised, to deliver a higher growth, more prosperous United Kingdom. But it was right in the face of the issues that we had that I acted decisively to ensure that we have economic stability.
Truss took office just 6 weeks ago. Two giants in the U.S. grocery industry are merging. Kroger agreed today to buy Albertsons in a deal totaling nearly $25 billion. Together, the companies own around 5,000 stores nationwide, including the Harris Teeter and Safeway chains. The deal is subject to federal regulatory approval. And on Wall Street, inflation fears pushed major stock indexes down from 1 to 3% for the day. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost more than 400 points to close at 29,634. The Nasdaq fell 327 points. The S&P 500 slipped 87. For the week, the Dow lost 1%. The Nasdaq fell 3%. The S&P 500 dropped 1.5%. And a passing of note, actor Robbie Coltrane, the half-giant Hagrid in the Harry Potter movies, has died in his native Scotland. He landed a breakthrough role in the 1990s British TV series Cracker, and starting in 2001, he appeared in all eight of the Harry Potter films. Robbie Coltrane was 72 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, why gas prices are so much higher in California than the rest of the country. David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart weigh in on the week's political headlines. Afghan poets find inspiration in exile, using art to channel their pain, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Elon Musk said today that his company, SpaceX, can no longer fund the Starlink satellite system in Ukraine. The service has helped both the Ukrainian military and civilians stay connected during the war with Russia. The announcement comes after Musk reportedly requested that the Pentagon take over funding for Starlink. It also follows backlash that Musk received for suggesting a peace plan to end the war that would require Ukraine cede territory to Russia. John Yang has the latest.
Judy, since February, more than 12,000 Starlink internet terminals have been delivered to Ukraine. They've been crucial to the country's efforts to regain territory. For instance, drone operators rely on the service to send live feeds to targeting units. Starlink has also been vital to troops staying in touch with their families. Today, Musk said SpaceX cannot indefinitely fund the system, which he says costs nearly $20 million a month. Last month, SpaceX asked the Pentagon to take over financing the service. Felicia Schwartz is the Financial Times U.S. Foreign Affairs and Defense correspondent. Felicia, thanks so much for joining us. How important has this system been to Ukraine in this war?
American and Ukrainian officials have described it to us as a total game changer, super important. As you said, it helps drone operators. It helps people stay in touch. It's basically a backup communications network when, you know, cell phone and internet infrastructure are down, and especially as Ukrainian forces are retaking area in the east of the country where there's not a lot of Ukrainian cell coverage, this has been crucial.
And has Musk just been donating this so far?
So it's been a mix. Musk and SpaceX have donated some. The U.S. government and European countries have donated some. There's also been some crowdfunding efforts, but he has donated some terminals as well.
And Musk, as we said, asked the Pentagon if they couldn't take this over. Where do things stand with that?
So the Pentagon said today that they are, you know, in active conversations with SpaceX and Musk trying to figure it out. They said, you know, they've received this communication from Musk expressing concern about the pricing. I know, you know, American officials I've spoken to have made it very clear that this they see, you know, satellite communications and these Starlink terminals in particular as being very, very important to Ukraine's war effort. And they said today that they are in ongoing talks with SpaceX and Elon Musk. And, you know, they've also identified some other companies, they would not say which ones, that also provide this kind of satellite communication function. And they're looking into that as well. I think it's a high priority to keep Ukrainian troops connected.
I mean, given all the assistance, the military assistance that the United States is providing, could this get wrapped into that, to that military aid?
So I think that is something that, you know, we're trying to report out and figure how this might be paid for. Some analysts suggested to us maybe the Pentagon would use the Defense Production Act, for example, to try to fund this. But I think they, you know, some U.S. funding is going to communications and satellite communications infrastructure and so on. So I think, you know, it depends on what the dollar amount is that they work out, how it will be kind of covered and the funds that have been allocated. And, you know, maybe Congress will have to play a role. But I think that will play out in the coming days and weeks.
You and your colleagues at the Financial Times have been reporting that there have been wide areas of Ukraine where this service has actually gone down, that it's not operating anymore. Any idea what caused this shutdown? And how has that affected Ukrainian military operations?
So beginning last month, Ukrainian troops started telling us about what they described in some places as catastrophic outages that have gotten in the way of their efforts to take territory back. I think we're kind of still trying to get to the bottom of what's going on here. Ukrainian officials have said to us they suspect there might be, you know, geographic limits that SpaceX is imposing. Some of these outages kind of came as Elon Musk was tweeting about a peace plan for Ukraine that, you know, Ukrainian officials and lots of observers see as quite favorable to Russia. It would involve annexing territory that Ukraine has made pretty clear that they don't want to give up. What might be known as geofencing or geographic limits in some areas might be one explanation. Officials have told me that, you know, Russian jamming might account for some of it as well. Perhaps Musk and SpaceX don't want Russian forces to be able to use the system, so they're, you know, being cautious about turning it back on in places that Ukrainian troops have arrived. But definitely it's had a big effect on the battlefield. And since we wrote that original story, we've heard that at least some of these affected units have been turned back on. But I think it will be very crucial in the days ahead that these troops can stay connected as they're making gains or trying to make gains in the south and are making gains there.
You mentioned that peace plan that Musk floated that got a frosty reception, to say the least, from the Ukrainians. I think it's fair to say it's often hard to determine Musk's motivations. Is there a connection, do you think, between that sort of failed trial balloon and what he's saying now?
I think it's hard to know, and I definitely wouldn't want to speculate. I think there's definitely some people we're talking to who think that's the case. I think others, you know, have pointed to what Musk had said himself, which is that he really fears escalation and, you know, wants to avoid a wider war. So I think, you know, obviously Musk is tweeting a lot about what he's doing and his intentions, and we're talking to other people in touch with him as well, and you know, trying to figure out what's going on there.
Felicia Schwartz of the Financial Times, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
China is set to hold its most important political meeting in decades. The Communist Party's 20th National Congress, which kicks off Sunday, will see a shakeup of the country's leadership. But the top job is all but secured, with President Xi Jinping expected to remain at the helm after scrapping term limits in 2018, paving the way for him to cement his status as China's most powerful leader since Mao Zedong. But it comes amid growing fears about what a return to one-man politics might mean for the future of the country. Special correspondent Patrick Falk begins his report in rural Shaanxi province, where Xi lived as a young man.
The ride is bumpy, but the surroundings are pristine, with fields brimming with crops. This is the village of Liangjiahe, considered a living shrine to China's leader. As a teenager, Xi Jinping was sent here under Mao Zedong's campaign to re-educate privileged urban youths. He spent 7 years in the village deep in rural Shaanxi province, living in caves carved out of the hills. In one of them, a case displaying books Xi is said to have read. In another, posters of modern China's founding father.
It was very hard time.
François Bougon is a former Beijing correspondent and author of Inside the Mind of Xi Jinping. He says Xi's time in Liangjiahe formed the foundations of his future.
The years in Liangjiahe is used right now in his political career. He can say he's a man of the people, a down-to-earth man, and not only the son of a revolutionary red aristocrat.
Xi's father suffered as a result of Mao Zedong's purge of potential rivals, and in Liangjiahe, the younger Xi endured hard labor. But far from turning against China's Communist Party, he embraced it. In Mao, he saw a role model.
He's the first leader since the death of Mao in 1976 to acknowledge the legacy of Mao without reservation. He follows Mao in the way he governs the party. The cult of personality, it's very Mao style.
Now, as the twice-a-decade party congress nears, Xi is expected to take a step closer to emulating his political hero. Having scrapped presidential term limits in 2018, he's paved the way for a historic third five-year term as leader.
And Xi's quest for power could extend well beyond that, with many political analysts believing, like Mao, he intends to rule for life.
But it comes as the country faces mounting challenges under the 69-year-old Xi Jinping's leadership. Ongoing and frequent lockdowns across the country under his signature zero-COVID policy have taken a heavy toll. The International Monetary Fund this week cut its growth forecast for China this year to 3.2%, its weakest expansion in more than four decades, excluding the initial outbreak of the COVID-19 crisis in 2020. Earlier this year, authorities warned of action against any criticism of the country's COVID policies. But there are plenty of signs of people cracking. This COVID testing booth was spotted recently sprayed with graffiti saying, "Give me freedom or give me death." Alfred Wu is an associate professor at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy at the National University of Singapore.
Lots of people were locked at home for months, then a lot of mental health issue. Now, youth unemployment rate is very, very high, almost 20%. So basically, it's some sort of failure in China, but Chinese leadership, particularly under Xi Jinping, insists this is the approach he wants to adopt.
China's two-term limit was established in 1982 by the reformist leader who followed Mao, Deng Xiaoping, to avoid the kind of chaos that can occur under a single authoritarian leader.
So Deng Xiaoping's reform tried to tackle this issue. Deng Xiaoping wanted more check and balance because they knew that Mao Zedong made a lot of mistakes.
They were more than mistakes. Tens of millions of people died as a result of Mao's failed economic policies and his cultural revolution that led to brutal purges of national and horrific scale. He was China's unchallenged revolutionary leader for more than three decades. As part of the shakeup of China's leadership at the Party Congress, political scientists like Wu Qiang expect Xi loyalists will replace outgoing members of China's top policy-making body, the Politburo Standing Committee, giving him a level of control unseen since the days of Mao.
A drastic change is happening with CCP's ruling approach, turning from an authoritarian system of market economy and globalization that's been running since 1992 to a totalitarian system. This totalitarian system is a new change for China's future and for the world. It's a fundamental change.
Under Xi, China's relationship with the West has become particularly fraught. His declaration of a no-limits partnership with Russia's Vladimir Putin just weeks before his invasion of Ukraine drew international criticism. It's raised questions also at home. Su Chindor is a senior fellow at the Pangao Institute.
Chinese principle is like respect for sovereignty and territorial integrity. Some of the behaviors, some of the policies of the Russian, of Russia, is not really in line with the Chinese principle.
Rising nationalism, fueled by Xi's assertive foreign policy, has also strained China's image. According to Pew Research, some 82% of Americans now have a negative view of China.
China's sense of insecurity and distrust towards international society results in international society suspicions and distrust towards China. As China closes its borders, it ends up in a confrontational and contradictory relationship with the international community.
Meanwhile, China's ambitions for national rejuvenation and some say global supremacy by 2049, when it marks the centenary of the People's Republic, have been dealt a fresh blow after the Biden administration rolled out sweeping regulations to limit Chinese access to semiconductors. It could crimp its ability to develop swathes of its economy. It's seen as the most aggressive action by President Biden yet to prevent China from developing technology that could pose a threat. It prompted an angry response from Beijing.
In order to maintain the hegemony of science and technology, the United States abused export control measures and maliciously blocked and suppressed Chinese enterprises. This approach deviates from the principle of fair competition and violates international economic and trade rules.
But even without that, the upcoming political gathering has fueled debate over whether one man should dominate this massive country and if it should turn away from the collective leadership that's transformed China into a powerhouse over the last four decades. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Patrick Falk in Beijing.
Gas prices in much of the country have dropped substantially this fall. But in California, the price per gallon has remained much higher than in other states. The costs are pushing some residents to the edge and raising concerns about whether price gouging is to blame. William Brangham has our report on what's behind the spike and the toll that it's taking on the Golden State.
Judy, this month, consumers in California were paying roughly $2.61 per gallon more than the national average for gas. The average there is about $6.15 a gallon now, but in some parts of the state, it's been $7 or more. We'll look at what's behind that spike in a moment. But first, we spent the last week talking to people across the state about how these prices at the pump are affecting their daily lives.
My name is Crystal Miller. I live in Los Angeles, California, and I work in social media and marketing. The gas prices in LA are super crazy high right now. It's about $6 or $7 a gallon, depending on where you live.
My name's Lee Gross. I live in Visalia, California, and I'm a semi-retired agricultural economist. We're just being a little more thoughtful about where we drive and what the value proposition is for the drive.
I'm LaRonnie Jerger. I am living in Northern California, Amador County, and I work for a major healthcare organization. I'm originally from Oklahoma, proud member of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. It's kind of terrifying, quite frankly, to see gas prices where they are.
My name is Linda Randall. I'm from Penn Valley, California. I'm an ex-financial analyst. And financially, you know, I'm not a wealthy person by any means. So I mind my pennies to try and get by.
Is it worth driving 20 miles and burning a gallon of gas to go buy ice cream at a place, one of our favorite places? Or can we buy the ice cream closer and save, you know, at this pace, $14?
There's so many malls here in LA, but it's so much easier and more convenient now to just shop online versus like wasting gas to drive out there, wasting gas trying to find parking, and then driving all the way back home, sitting in crazy LA traffic.
I saw $6.79 a gallon on Friday. I didn't have to put gas in my car, so I didn't stop, but I saw it and I was just like, what? It was a real double take moment to see that here in my little town. It was kind of like, what? Where am I right now?
One of my hobbies is singing, and I sing with the San Francisco Symphony Choir, which is a big deal. But if I want to sing with the San Francisco Symphony, that's 150 miles. It costs me between $70 and $80 to go round trip, depending on the price. And so the calculus that I'm making is that's a lot of money.
The higher gas price comes into play when we do things like support a local beef producer, local 35 miles away. We've been buying directly from him, and we rethink that. You know, we would like to support him, but with $5, $6, $7 gas, you put that added gas cost into the price of the product that you're picking up, and you think, let's change that.
My parents actually live towards the Long Beach area, and I live more towards the airport. And so I'm the one who drives out to see them every week. And so the gas affects me, which is why I pretty much only go out there like once a week.
I drive a very economical car that gets about 35 miles to the, or 32 miles to the gallon, you know, on the highway. I could fill up for $35. It's almost $70 now to fill my little 11-gallon tank.
I have a sister in Washington State, another sister in Iowa City, and a brother in Albuquerque. Now, to hop in my car and drive 1,500 miles to Albuquerque, the cost of gas to do that, that makes that trip almost impossible for me to think about doing. And that means I don't see my family as much.
To help people deal with those costs, the state has started to give out inflation relief payments of just over $1,000 to 23 million Californians. And Governor Gavin Newsom has called for a new windfall tax on oil and gas companies in the face of their record profits. But it is still a difficult time for many. So for a closer look at what's behind all of this, I'm joined by Severin Borenstein. He's professor of business and public policy at the University of California, Berkeley. Professor Borenstein, thanks so much for being here. We heard some genuine impacts on people because of these high prices. People will look at what's happening in California and say, aha, it's California's fees and regulations and environmental rules that are driving up the price of gas there. How much of that is true?
Well, that's definitely a part of it. California has higher gas taxes than the rest of the country. It has some environmental fees from a cap and trade program and a low carbon fuel standard. And it uses a cleaner burning gasoline that costs a little bit more to make. But when you add all that up, right now that accounts for about 85 cents a gallon. That's a big difference, but that's only a part and less than half of the differential we're seeing right now between California and the rest of the country.
So I understand that back in 2015, you saw a similar spike that went up and never went back down. And you referred to this as the mystery gasoline surcharge. What is that?
So what happened is we had a refinery fire. The price spiked up, and the wholesale price, the spot price of gasoline, spiked up first. And then the price came back down. And we've had these happen ever since we went to a different blend of gasoline in 1995. And usually the retail price then comes back down and the differential is back to that basis of taxes and environmental fees. In 2015, that didn't happen. And on average, since 2015, California's prices have averaged an extra 30 cents a gallon higher than the rest of the country beyond what you can explain through higher taxes and fees. Overall, since 2015, that amounts to over $40 billion for California drivers.
I mean, that's a huge amount of money out of people's pockets. I mean, is that just a function of oil companies and gas companies and refiners making a profit as companies are want to do? Is that what's going on there?
Well, we're not exactly sure what's going on. I have been arguing for the last 7 years that California really needs to invest some money in a serious investigation to find out, because this is a huge amount of money beyond what you could normally explain with just the taxes and fees. It is clear that that differential over the last 7 years is not at the refinery level, because that spot price of gasoline, the price for giant shipments of gasoline, is actually about in line with where it should be. The differential seems to be downstream in the marketing, distribution, and retailing sector. Those sectors have very complex contracts with the refiners. The refiners have a lot of influence over what they charge. And it's unclear who's actually collecting the money and why that is so resilient. One of the things that is worth noting is that California has a much smaller share of off-brand stations than the rest of the country. A very small share of our gasoline goes through the mom and pop. So we're not seeing the discipline enforced on competition that we would in other parts of the country where those stations make up a bigger share.
I mean, some of the critics of the oil and gas companies say that this is price gouging, that the prices are up and they have no incentive whatsoever to bring them back down, regardless of the economy. Is there any evidence that that's true?
Well, I haven't seen any evidence that they're actually colluding. Short of that, these firms are going to try to make as much money as they can. We rely on competition to keep them from driving those prices up. And California definitely has a less competitive gasoline market than the rest of the country, partially because we use this cleaner burning gasoline formulation that we can't trade with the rest of the country, partially because two refiners in California control about half of the entire gasoline market. So we really do have a potential problem here. The gasoline companies claim that the real problem is various regulatory barriers, and I think that's worth looking into. Unfortunately, the politicians get very interested in this when the price spikes and then the price comes back down, and even if it stays a little higher than it should, they move on to other issues. I think it's time that we really need to dig into this and not lose focus.
All right, that is Severin Borenstein at UC Berkeley. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
We are in the final weeks before the midterm elections, and nearly 1.8 million Americans have already cast a ballot. Meanwhile, in Washington, the January 6th committee has voted to subpoena former President Trump as part of its investigation into the attack on the U.S. Capitol. That brings us to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart. That is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, columnist for the Washington Post. Hello to both of you.
Judy.
It is very good to see you smiling, both of your smiling faces. I think you're smiling. So the January 6th committee, David, ninth public hearing, and they did vote, as we just said, to subpoena the former president. We don't know whether he's going to come. If he did, first of all, do you think he will? And if he did, do you think it would make a difference?
If he did, I think cows would fly. Yeah, I don't think he's going to do it. Well, first, would it make a difference? In the polling, nothing has made a difference. The public opinion is exactly where it was when this committee first started going, so nothing has changed. The reason I don't think he's going to do it is, even though he has said he wants to do it and he believes he's his best advocate, he's being investigated by the Justice Department for the same thing. No lawyer lets their client go under oath and confess something. He's being investigated over here. And so he's already shown he's willing to take the Fifth, as he did in the New York State, New York investigations. And so I just think that spectacle is one we will have to just dream about.
Cows flying? What do you see, Jonathan?
I mean, I would love to see cows fly, but I know I will be disappointed.
Until you're standing under one.
Well, that's true.
All right, wait, but we just started here.
Right. So he's not going to testify, and I don't think the January 6th committee had any expectation that he would. However, I do think that the January 6th committee felt it was important, given all the evidence that they had, given all the evidence that they had presented to the American people over nine hearings, that it was the logical thing to do. And I think it was the right thing to do, whether he shows up or not, because what they are doing is investigating an attack on the United States instigated by the President of the United States. And the report, these hearings and the report that will be released later in the fall is as much for the American people right now as it is for the American people and the world decades down the road. There needs to be an accounting, and what the committee has done is part of that.
About history.
About history, yes.
Is one of, I know you, and you were saying that earlier today, but David, I mean, we don't know what's going to happen in midterm elections, clearly, but if this committee wraps it up in a few weeks and the Democrats lose the majority in the House, what in sum will this committee have accomplished, do you think?
Yeah, I don't think it'll have much political effect on the midterms. I think people are pretty locked in and they're voting on their own lives, not so much on January 6th. But it surprised me. You know, there was a lot more to investigate and a lot more to reveal than I knew about, and I think a lot of us knew about. Like, we all saw January 6th on January 6th, but there was a lot of behind the scenes things. There was a lot more planning and plotting than we knew about. And then just to get the members of the Trump administration, some of his allies, some of the Proud Boys, to get the testimony from those sorts of people, very incriminating testimony. So it will A, be part of the historical record, and B, potentially be a groundwork for if the Justice Department does decide to do something.
What do you think the accumulated contribution or not it will be when this committee wraps up, if it does get, because there is some speculation the Republicans will completely disband it.
Oh, they're totally going to disband it, and they're going to shift their focus. If they continue anything related to January 6th, it won't be what the Select Committee is doing now. They'll turn their attention to Speaker Pelosi, as has been telegraphed for months now, which is why I thought in the hearing yesterday was really interesting. The behind-the-scenes video that we saw of Speaker Pelosi and Leader Schumer pleading, all the phone calls that they were making behind the scenes to do something at the Capitol, in sort of contrasting that with what the President of the United States was not doing.
And David, and so as you look at the sum total of all this, I mean, that was a pretty dramatic thing. There they are on the phone, you know, begging the parts of government that can do something to do something.
Yeah, I mean, I think the video that the committee has thrown before us is the highlight of what they've done. It brings you back. And even this, I was sort of, A, impressed by their calm under pressure. Pelosi, Schumer, McConnell was in there, Steny Hoyer was in there. I was also a little depressed that they're just freelancing. Like, they're calling, let's call the governor, let's call the governor of Maryland, let's call the governor of Virginia. It's like there's no plan for what to do in a case of this and this kind of emergency or any kind of emergency. So they were, there was not a set of procedures they were following. They were just freelancing. I thought they did impressively, but in the future, we should have like, okay, this will happen and this will happen and this will happen if there's not even an incursion like this, but some sort of crisis at the Capitol.
But the key thing here is they were freelancing because the unimaginable happened. The President of the United States was not stepping in and doing what is his constitutional duty, which is to protect and preserve the Constitution, and a branch of government was under attack. So yeah, they were freelancing. They're trying to figure out where can we step in to save the situation.
And they clearly didn't see it coming. Yeah. Okay, today is October the 14th. David, I looked at the calendar. We are about 3.5 weeks away from the midterm election. People are voting now, but that's the day. Congress hangs in the balance. I will say I was in Wisconsin last weekend. Republicans are very much pushing crime and public safety, and Democrats will take us down a dark road. Democrats are pushing, they're too far to the right, and abortion. What does this campaign, this season, look like to you right now?
Well, if you're a Democrat, the happy thing is a lot of these races are close. In a lot of these states, like Wisconsin, Joe Biden has an approval rating like low 40s, even 39, 42. In a normal year, that would be disaster for a lot of these Democratic candidacies. But it's not been a disaster. The polls are close. So if you're a Democrat, you're thinking somehow we're defying history a little here if the polls are right. If you're a Republican, I think there are two things that would cheer you. The first is the Democrats had a swing in their direction about 2-3 months ago. It seems like in the last month, the Republicans have had a bit of a swing in their direction. And second, if you look at where the campaigns are spending their money and where they're pulling out because they've sort of given up, the Democrats are spending a lot of money in places that they should not have to defend. districts where Biden won by 7, where Biden won by 13, and Republicans are pouring money into those districts. And that suggests that both parties have these internal polls that suggest there's places Republicans are threatening that would seemingly be lean or safe Democratic districts. And that may be that there's a sign of some sort of Republican surge we're not seeing in the public polls.
What do you see?
I agree with David that in the summer, it looked like the wind was at Democrats' backs. They're almost euphoric about their political prospects. But as with everything in politics, the pendulum always swings back, and this is where we are. And what I foresee is what my colleague Jennifer Rubin said this morning, is that we could be looking at two waves, not a tsunami, but two waves. A red wave where you have races that are determined by crime, inflation, fears of a recession, or you could have the blue wave where the issue of abortion, threats to democracy, reigns supreme. I think where Democrats are able to make the economic link between bodily autonomy, reproductive rights for women, and economics, maybe they can eat into some of that advantage Republicans have on the economy and inflation and recession. But again, look, this is someplace where we've never been, where even the pollsters are saying, we don't know what's going to happen.
But you're saying with two waves, who benefits if it's two waves? We
don't know. That's
there could be a wave in each direction.
Right. Right.
And they crash against each other. We don't know.
It's advanced physics. I did see a poll of what issue are you voting on most? And in this poll, the number one issue that is motivating people to go to the polls is making sure the other team loses. So it's not even the economy or it's not abortion. It's like, I just don't like those guys. And so that's there, and I think that's why the two parties are so locked at even, and not a lot has changed, even as the presidential approval goes up and down.
So that means these two neighbors we interviewed near Madison, Wisconsin, Columbia County, Wisconsin, who are trying really hard, and they are still friends, but they disagree completely on everything, including who to vote for. But they're still friends. Good fences make good neighbors. So, David, you had a column today about what's going on in Los Angeles with the city council, but it was about more than that. It was about there have been resignations, but before that it got really messy. And you talked about how this could be the racial future of this country. What did you mean?
Yeah, well, managing diversity is hard. Diversity is fabulous. But politically managing diversity and staying together as a country when we get increased diversity, when there's no majority group, which is where we're headed, that's a political challenge. And so what disturbed me about the comments by the Los Angeles City Council members was not only the raw racism, which was disturbing, but listening to their taped conversation was their assumption first that we were all on ethnic teams. There's like the black team, the Latino team, the white team, the Armenian team, the Korean team, and that these teams are permanently at war. And so there's always been ethnic politics. But as some Los Angeles analyst said, there's always been negotiations, but this was Game of Thrones. And so if we enter a world where we have all this great diversity, but politics is really ginned up by politicians using ethnic and racial appeals to fight political battles, then you really get a very ugly atmosphere. And it's already obviously happening to some degree. I mean, what is Donald Trump? But it's just how hard it is to manage diversity going forward.
Where are you coming down on this?
Well, I read your column, David. I should have written down the headline. But this idea that, because it was something about this is what happens when everything is viewed by race.
There it is.
Right. This is what happens when race is everything. And I got your argument. It's very utopian, and I am one of those people who wishes we could live in that place, but we can't and we won't. The best we can do is strive to get there. I listened to the recordings of the comments, and what struck me was that they sounded like old school politicians having a backroom conversation. And when politicians get behind closed doors, the conversations can be pretty rough. But when you're talking about the spoils of power, and in this case, it was redistricting, it gets ugly. And what these tapes do is bring us on the inside. I don't think those conversations are new, those types of conversations are new. It's just that we're hearing them now with our own ears. But we have to remember something. And this is where I take issue with the headline, which some I write my own headlines. I don't know if you do. But the idea that Black people or people of color are the ones who are foisting race on the country as something that needs to be dealt with is it's problematic because it ignores the history of this country. I have here a picture that I took at the Legacy Museum in Montgomery, Alabama, and in the old location, there was a huge wall with all of these horrific signs. One says, no Negroes allowed after sundown. Another sign, whites only within city limits after dark. Another one, no N-words, Puerto Rican, Mexicans allowed. Another one, we want white tenants in our white community. Yeah. It's not that Black and brown people are so focused on race because that's all they care about. They focus and are paying attention to race because they have to, because of signs like that. And that's just one example. And one last thing, we also have to remember that we are 57 years after the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act. That means we are only 57 years of truly being a democracy. And that's within the living lifetimes of people.
Yeah, I mean, I said exactly that. I mean, I said white supremacy created these categories.
Yeah.
And the question is, are we content with the categories or are we gonna militarize the categories?
We may continue this conversation. David Brooks, Jonathan Capehart, thank you both.
Thanks, Judy.
Poetry has a special place in the heart of Afghans. It has played a prominent role from the country's ancient history to its present day. But when the Taliban took over, many of Afghanistan's most popular poets had to flee. They are now figuring out how to find inspiration in exile. Ali Rogan talked to several masters of the art for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas.
In post-Taliban Afghanistan, the new constitution was written in prose. But the idea of the new Afghanistan, peaceful, pluralistic, and democratic, was cloaked in poetry. Starting with the lyrics of the new national anthem, written in 2006.
This is Afghanistan, and this is the honor of every Afghan. This is the home of the sword, and this is the home of the peace.
It's such a hopeful message.
Thank you.
Was that intentional?
Yeah.
Abdul Bari Jahani is one of Afghanistan's most prominent contemporary poets. He's spent most of his adult life in the United States, fleeing Afghanistan after the Soviet invasion in 1979. Since then, he's wielded his most powerful weapons, his pen and his voice.
This is what all the artists and the poets and the writers were doing their part in the jihad or in fighting against the occupiers. And the same role they played against the civil war after the Soviet withdrawal. Poets were opposed to the Taliban too.
Above all, Jahani wrote about the need for Afghans of all ethnicities to unite, a theme that the then new President Hamid Karzai wanted to promote in the new anthem.
It's about the pride we have taken in our country, in our history, in our present.
Karzai's choice of a well-known Pashto language poet was also deliberate. Poetry is central to Afghanistan's past and present, not just as a storytelling method, but as part of the story. One of the most famous examples, Malalai of Mewand, the namesake of Pakistani activist Malala Yousafzai. In 1880, Afghans were fighting their second war against the British. During the Battle of Mewand, the soldiers grew demoralized. Malalai roused them with a stirring short poem in the Pashto language known as a Lundai.
Young love. If you do not fall in the Battle of Mewand, by God, someone is saving you as a symbol of shame.
These types of verses, usually written by women, are what drew Shafika Qawwak to poetry.
it's a way of resistance for women. It has been throughout the history against patriarchy.
But patriarchy was part of the Taliban. When it came to power in the mid-1990s, women were largely erased from public life. So too were modern music and poetry, except for the Taliban's own, which fixated on war and martyrdom. When the Taliban fell in early 2002, Kupal Wak was 8 years old. As a student and poet, she flourished. In 2014, Kupal Wak recited a poem at the presidential palace, paying tribute to another symbol of Afghan national unity, the flag.
I kind of glorify the flag as the flag of a land where there is love, it is free, it is prosperous, it is flourishing, it is youth, it is beautiful. The Taliban website wrote about that, that this is a very erotic poem, and she actually disrespected the Afghan flag.
The poem, My Flag is Made of Colors, became a surprise hit, catapulting Kupal Wak to fame.
I was not expecting that it would go that viral. I think it was one of the most important event of my life.
I saw her naked on my...
In those years, the poetry scene that Kupal Wak was part of embodied modern Afghanistan. Men and women took part in Sher Jangi, a traditional game that's a mix between a poetry slam and a rap battle, like this one at Kabul University in May 2021. Just 3 months later, all of those forms of expression and the drive for gender equality were lost when the Taliban took over Kabul and the Americans withdrew. Kupal Wak escaped Afghanistan and is now in Canada. 1 year on, she feels no more settled.
I think I'm not only exiled from my country, but I'm exiled from myself.
For now, she has put down her pen.
This grief is so, it's like an ocean. It's drowning me, and I don't know how to swim.
Sometimes, though, grief inspires, as it did for poet and singer Gudar Zazai. Now living in Pakistan, he wrote Ak Watan Watan, Oh, Homeland, after celebrating his first Eid holiday away from loved ones.
We had lost our homeland. So in a very disturbed and crying state, I wrote the poem Ak Watan Watan, and then I was able to sing it with music.
Back under Taliban rule, popular music is once again considered sinful. Jahani's national anthem no longer plays, nor does the tricolor flag fly. But Jahani says that's just Afghan history running its course.
This is the luck of the Afghans. Whichever party comes to power, they change the flag, they change the coins, they change the banknotes, they change the constitution.
What remains is the desire for knowledge and freedom. Some women have opened unofficial schools to teach girls beyond grade 6 when the Taliban says they must stop learning. And a favorite act of public protest, gathering to read.
Do you believe that will continue despite the Taliban being in power again?
Oh, yeah, of course. This is how we survive. This is how we survive. And we will survive.
Those who think they can destroy our identity, culture, and music by removing artists and poets should think again. No one can take Afghanistan from us, and each of us can work for our people in our professions from any corner of the world.
The Taliban may have reconquered the country, but in Afghanistan, history shows that the pen always outlives the sword. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Allie Rogan.
It's an enduring reminder the pen does outlive the sword. Thank you, Allie. And before we go, don't forget to join moderator Yamiche Alcindor and her panel on tonight's Washington Week. And tomorrow on PBS News Weekend, a look at two races in Georgia that could help decide control of the U.S. Senate and the direction of the country. And with that, that's the NewsHour for tonight. I'm Judy Woodruff. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. Please stay safe, and we'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by Economy for 160 years. BNSF, the engine that connects us. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions, and friends of the NewsHour, including Kathy and Paul Anderson, and Camilla and George Smith. The Walton Family Foundation, working for solutions to protect water during climate change so people and nature can thrive together. The William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, for more than 50 years advancing ideas and supporting institutions to promote a better world at hewlett.org. And friends of the NewsHour. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.